Hi, this is Chris Vinicum and this is The Gear Show, a brand new helping of guitar goodness from the people behind Guitarist, Total Guitar and Guitar Techniques magazines and musicradar.com. Coming up, we'll have the highlights of the hottest new gear to come into the office in the last few weeks, including the Mesa Boogie Rectiverb 25, brand new acoustics from Yamaha, the Tone King Royalist and much more. Total Guitar's 90-second review will tell you everything you need to know about a new product in a minute and a half. We'll take you behind the scenes with manufacturers in Meet Your Maker, and what's in store will show you what's flying off the shelves in your local guitar shop. First, here's our test pilot, Darren Charles from Godsticks, with a demo of the new Mesa Boogie Rectiverb 25.
I'm Darren from Godsticks, and I've been invited by Guitarist magazine to try the Mesa Rectiverb 25. I believe the Rectiverb 25 was created in response to the positive feedback Mesa received about the mini rectifier. People would like wanted to see it in a combo format. Rival a dual rectifier in terms of power and aggression. It's extremely responsive to your playing. It's as good as any Mesa amp that I've ever played, and it's loud, and they're always phenomenally loud, and this one isn't any different. And there aren't many amps that deliver both a great clean sound and great dirty sound, but Mesa is definitely one of those companies, and this is no exception. Also, because of the EL84s, on the pushed mode on channel 1, you get some great Marshall-esque sort of breakup tones that you don't normally get on 6L6 amps. I've owned a lot of Mesas, and I can honestly say this is the closest they've come to producing a do-it-all amp.
Hey, I'm Jamie from Guitarist magazine, and today we've got three L-series Yamaha acoustics to show you. The L-series has been around for a while, but these ones have got some new features, including the acoustic resonance enhancement treatment, which has previously only been a feature of their higher-end acoustics, and a zero-impact pickup system. Now, that pickup system is very low-key. You won't really see many features that let you know it's there, but it's very effective, and hopefully you'll hear that on the demo that we're now about to play for you.
Next, we're going to head over to GAK in Brighton to find out what's in store.
Hi, it's Mark from GAK.co.uk and I'm here in our Brighton store to give you an overview of the new gear that we've got in store this month. I'm going to head around the shop and find some GAK staff members to give us a little demo and a bit of a chat about the gear that they're really into and want to show you guys. Okay, so we're here in the guitar department with Matt Knight, who is the shop manager.
Hello.
Matt, what have you got to show us and what is it that you like about it so much?
Basically, here in store, we are really lucky to get a lot of really high-end Gibsons and a lot of kind of unique pieces. So we've got this 335, which most people will recognise the shape, but what's special about this one, it's a 59 reissue, and it's one of only five worldwide to be finished in this colour. So this colour represents one of the Les Pauls that's actually finished in this from a book called Beauty of the Burst. It's really nice, it's really unique. Comes out of the Nashville factory, which is where Gibson now producing some of the more custom 335s, 9s and stuff like that, where a lot of the other ones are made in the Memphis factory. And it features all the 2013 specs, all the new features they put on the Gibson custom shops. So on the neck join, you've got hot hide glue, so it's a much better marriage between neck and body wood, so you get a lot more resonance and sustain. Upgraded, more vintage-like machine heads, and vintage-correct truss rod inside, which is no tubing. Now, a lot of people say they're quite minimal differences, but obviously, if you're going for a 59 reissue, you want to try and be as close as you possibly can to the original thing, really. Redesigned what they call custom bucker pickups. So these are the closest thing you'll get to an original 59 path. Using Alnico 3 magnets, and they're unevenly wound on each one as well. So they kind of dissect originals and kind of put everything together to kind of get as close as possible as you're going to get to the original, including slightly oxidizing the hardware and the Voss finish. And it, overall, it's just an amazing player, straight out of the box, great guitar, sounds really nice, resonantly unplugged and plugged in as well, which I think we're going to do in a second.
Well, let's do that. Let's plug it in and we'll see how it sounds.
Cool.
Next up, here's Northern Irish blues rock sensation Simon McBride in action with his PRS 408.
Okay, so the guitar I play is it's a PRS, Paul Reed Smith. And the one I've been using for about 3-4 years now is a 408. This guitar I'm playing right now is not my own one, simply because the one I play is nothing different. It's pretty much exactly the same. Everything's pretty stock, pretty standard on it. It suits me for what I need to do. It kind of gives me those kind of single coil sounds, and if I want the full humbucker sounds as well. There's two types. There's one which is like this, is kind of semi hollow, and then there's one which is a solid body. I have both. They both sound pretty similar. This semi hollow just sounds a little more transparent, but not everything else is pretty much the same. So it has, you know, a three-way toggle switch on it. Typical volume and tone. The tone on guitars I never really use. I don't understand them. That's just my personal opinion. And it has two wee little toggle switches, which you have them in the down position. Everything's in full humbucker mode. When you switch them both up, puts everything in single coil mode, but it adds a number of coils to the pickup when you switch it to single coil, so you don't get that volume drop where most guitars, if you have a coil tap, slight volume decrease, but this one doesn't do it. So you can also have, you know, if you want your bridge pickup in full humbucker mode, if you want this one in single coil mode, you can, you know, mix and match, which is kind of cool. If I put it in single coil mode, I just have the amp, you know, set on pretty clean. I'll just play some stuff, you can hear it, so. If I switch pickups, that's in single coil, you know, as you can hear, it's pretty varied already. So if I flick it back to, you know, full humbucker mode. As you can hear, you know, it's when you have it in both positions, you know, the single coil or humbucker, it's the same sound you're getting. It's just one slightly brighter than the other, really. And that's what I kind of like. I don't want a guitar that has, you know, 15 different sounds on it, because that just confuses me. You know, I would be standing in the middle of a song going, what switch am I on? You know, that just freaks me out. I like simplicity. So, you know, if I put a bit of dirt on it, you know, you can... So yeah, that's what I use. It's the PRS-408.
Hi, this is Chris from Guitarist, and I'm here with the amplifier formerly known as the Tone King Majesty 45C, which has been renamed the Royalist for legal reasons. Regardless, it's essentially a boutique take on classic JTM 45 and Plexi Brit Rock tones, and it's a bit of an animal, although you can tame it with the onboard attenuator. That said, for the following demo, we've just cranked the amp right up and let the guitars do the talking. The first thing that you're going to hear is the amplifier in isolation with a Gibson ES-335 and a Fender Strat. We've used the Strat's neck pickup and the 335's bridge pickup, and in both instances, played around with the volume control so you can hear the difference between the full bore overdriven sound of everything on 10 and what happens when you back off that volume control and introduce some clean sounds into the equation. After that, you'll hear a full piece of music using both guitars and the amp on 10 throughout. I hope you enjoy it.
Okay, we found our way around to the pedal section of our Brighton store, and I'm here with Jay Cross, who is the assistant manager. Jay, what have you got to show us?
I've got the Wampler Ace 30. Wampler are a really, really cool American boutique pedal brand. They're actually a brand that we've been trying to get hold of for quite a while. And we finally, I think it was last month, actually, we started doing them. This was the first pedal that pretty much everyone who works here wanted to try, and it absolutely has not let anyone down. Essentially, it's a Vox AC30 preamp. Mm-hmm. So you've got two-band EQ with a top cut. You've also got separate volume and gain controls, just like any sort of standard AC30. The other really cool thing with it, though, which is something that, you know, is a bit of a drawback of some of the AC models being single channel amps, you've actually got the boost control there with a separate boost volume control on there. And you've got the option of switching between a 30 and a 15 watt headroom selector switch, which just gives you a little bit more gain if you're, you know, on the 15 watt without absolutely deafening everyone at home. Yeah, but really, really great pedals, super high quality, and yeah, we absolutely love them.
Let's plug it in and see what it sounds like.
Let's go.
Next, it's Angry Bird time as Total Guitar's Chris Bird goes metal with the Jim Root Jazzmaster in our 90-second review.
Slipknot and Stone Sour Axeman Jim Root's signature Jazzmaster sees Fender's original template for this guitar stretched to the very limit. Gone are the soap bar size single coils, floating vibrato and alder body, replaced by a pair of active EMG humbuckers, hardtail strap bridge and a hefty hunk of mahogany. Gone also are the dual tone circuits, leaving just a volume control and pickup selector. The fret markers are gone too. Now one thing's for sure, Jim's Jazzmaster is not for jazz. Of course, heavy metal is the natural environment for the Jim Jazz, and the EMG 81 bridge humbucker delivers knife point precise rhythm and cutting lead tones, perfect for Hetfield and Hammett type thrash. Tuned to drop B or even lower, and the Jim Root Jazz spews filthy but defined riffing. You'll need heavy strings if you're down tuning, and you'll be glad of Fender's locking tuners keeping things steady. The EMG 60 neck pickup does decent clean sounds, and it delivers smooth lead tones. The chunky neck and jumbo frets make for a satisfying playing experience. Top fret access is decent too. Jim Root has spec'd his Jazzmaster so it's pretty much identical to his Strat. It all begs the question, when does a Jazzmaster stop being a Jazzmaster? And while the list price of a little over £1,700 might be a little terrifying, we like this guitar and we'll be keeping our eyes peeled for it at a street price around £1,300.
Now it's time to meet your maker with Taylor Guitars.
To make a guitar feels like, it feels like a journey. It feels like you had to travel somewhere, because the whole process is one of gradually making smaller and smaller and smaller minute adjustments to this finished thing until finally it's done. So you start with big tools, big rough cuts, big pieces of wood, and slowly start removing everything that doesn't need to be there. So the whole thing is this gradually diminishing, increasingly careful process until you finally get where it needed to go, and then you just stop touching it. At a certain point, I don't know if many artists can really separate themselves out of the work they do. And so for me, as I relate to building a guitar, there are so many different factors and so many variables that can influence the way your thought process, the way you're going to go about something, just the very motions of your hands that day, how sharp your tools are. There are so many different variables that you're going to approach it with the knowledge that you're there in that present moment, and the instrument is going to reflect the experience that you've had as a builder plus the inspiration that you have in that very moment. So really, an instrument ends up being a snapshot of what that builder was like, their whole state of being at the time that it was built. There's so many different avenues and so many different seemingly unrelated activities that go into building one guitar. Each have their own unique kind of pleasures that go with them. Like, I love sharpening tools still. Just the peripheral activities of making a tool ready to do its task is wonderful. I love bending the sides and feeling a piece of really stiff wood that grew straight and true, feeling it slowly be formable and take on this new shape where it's really gonna sing. Carving braces and wringing every last bit of tone or volume out of a diaphragm, of this moving plate that's the top of a guitar or the back of a guitar, and getting the just the right size and shape on every one of those components. They all have a certain, they've all got their own charms in a way. So I don't know if I could really say there's one particular part of building a guitar, but I will say that to tune it up when it's finally done and play the first couple of notes and hear how all these parts for the first time are working together, that's pretty special. The steel string guitar in particular is a very young instrument. If you look at the music world as a whole, you look at pianos, which have hundreds of years of development behind them. You look at the bowed instrument world, violins, where the violin really reached its modern form 300 years ago. You look at clarinets, you look at all these instruments that have hundreds of years of development and reached a certain level of refinement where they were more than what a musician could ask for. The steel string guitar is really only about 90 years old now. And right from its birth, it was built in a factory setting. Classical guitar tradition is pretty large, but not really the steel string guitar world, kind of what we consider the modern guitar. Over my working lifetime, what my goal is to take this thing that we've built, these guitars that are really consistently good, they're real expressive, they're fine instruments, but continuing to refine and develop them until they turn into something that is more than what a musician could ask for. That's what's next.
Next, Neville Martin and myself get to grips with the Holy Grail in the shape of an original 1957 Gibson Les Paul Jr. and compare it to the current crop of single pickup guitars.
I'm Neville Martin. I'm here to talk about single pickup guitars. I've had a bit of a flirtation with them over the years, and I actually really like them. A lot of people think they're quite restricted, or presume they must be restricted, but when you look at people over the years who've used them, like Clapton with his Firebird 1, Pat Travers, great fan of Pat Travers I am, Stevie Marriott in Humble Pie, he used to use a single pickup guitar sometimes, and of course we've now got Billy Joe Armstrong and loads of guys down there the years have used them. Leslie West with Mountain, fantastic guitars. There's something about the tone of a single pickup guitar, and it's all about the tone, really, of a single pickup guitar. This guitar here is a 1957 Les Paul Jr. Sadly, it isn't mine. And this probably is the benchmark, certainly one of the two main benchmarks of single pickup guitarage. And it's a wonderful, wonderful machine. It's made of all the right woods. It's got a lovely 57 P90 on it. Sounds wonderful. And what the single pickup ethos is all about is learning how to get the most out of the guitar You learn what the volume control can do. You learn how the volume control affects the tone. You learn how the tone control affects the tone and the dynamics of the guitar overall. This guitar, in the right hands, I'm not saying they're my hands, but in the right hands, can give you all kinds of tones, from the thickest, fattest, dirty sounds to really sweet, almost acoustic sounds, if you're brave enough with those controls, and you need to be, because that's what it's all about. Here's an example. Look, I'm going to put the tone control on 3.5. I've got the volume control also on 3.5, and that really isn't a million miles away. From an acoustic guitar, that in a mix that wouldn't offend the average acoustic strummer's ear. But then, if I whack that volume control right up to 10, that lovely, dirty. So that's volume control on 10 and tone control on 3.5. If you whack the tone up to 10. It's a really lovely, there's edge to it, but the great thing about the Junior is where the pole pieces lie is quite away from the bridge, so it's not quite as brittle as on some where the pickup's very close to the bridge saddle or where the saddles would be. So you get an innate fatness to the guitar, so it... I mean, anybody who knows Leslie West with Mountain, you're going to recognise that sound. It's an absolute beautiful thing, plays beautifully. But it is all about the tone. It's learning where, you know, a lot of people will just turn that volume down to, say, 7 for average riff and rhythm work, you know. Whack it up for lead. So there's everywhere on this tone control is a different kind of sound, and you really need to learn to work with it and forget the fact that you don't have a pickup selector switch and you can't flip to the next pickup for this big fat fluty tone. You've got to work with the guitar, and it's a bit like when you restrict yourself in playing. You know, if you say I'm only going to play position one, shape one, but I need to milk that shape for all it's worth, and you actually learn to find out much more about a position on the guitar, an area on the guitar, and the same goes with single pickup guitar. You learn what that guitar is all about and how to make the most of that guitar.
So it's my turn to get the grips with the Holy Grail in the shape of this beautiful 1957 Les Paul Junior that you can see here. First thing that springs to mind when giving it a spin is just how great the neck feels. This fantastic sort of chunky feel to it that's incredibly comfortable to play. Dimensions are very, very pleasing. And then over at the body end of the spectrum, this beautiful kind of lacquer checking pattern here, which, you know, it's really nice to see something that's actually really aged and not kind of fake vintage style relicking. Because, you know, there definitely is a difference when you see it for real. And it's such a vibey instrument. It's just begs to be played, really. And so to echo a couple of things that Neville already said, obviously there's a huge amount of variation possible from the volume and tone controls, despite the perceived limitations of a single pickup guitar. But one of the things that I really like about this as well is that even with everything rolled up to full tilt, There's a hell of a lot of range that you can get just by varying what you're doing with your right hand. So for instance, the sort of full throttle sound, you've got a very nice kind of... very sort of nice, searing kind of lead sound that's going to, you know, sit right up there in a kind of very present up front place in a mix. But then if you take the pick away and use the flesh of your thumb and fingertip and play the same sort of part, you can... you can get a much kind of creamier sound, especially if you position your right hand up here towards the fretboard, which is you know, it's quite a contrast to the... And that's, you know, that's quite a lot of dynamic range there, you know, just from variation really with the right hand. And the same goes for rhythm sounds as well, because, you know, you've got this sort of thing. Nice kind of dark, velvety, smoky kind of rhythm sound, and then the same sort of thing with the pick. It's much more kind of strident, much more rock and roll. So that kind of range before you've even touched the controls is incredibly impressive. Unfortunately, of course, as beautiful as a guitar like this is, not many of us can actually afford an original 1950s Gibson. But happily, there are quite a few companies who do make single pickup guitars, and they've all got different takes on a theme. So we've chosen four quite different instruments, all with just the one pickup, and we're going to give them a spin and let you know some of our thoughts, and then maybe you can make up your mind as to which one you prefer.
This is a Gordon Smith GS1. It's a lovely little guitar. They've been making these for years and years and years. Clearly, it's inspired by the double cutaway Les Paul Jr., which is a slightly later guitar than the 57 we were playing just now. The Gordon Smith here has a humbucker at the bridge, which is a really nice sound. I like it because a humbucker does have a naturally edgy sound to it if you play it in the right way. This has also got this particular one has got a couple of optional things which I personally wouldn't have. It's starting to overcomplicate something that's a lovely, simple guitar. But they're quite good. They're interesting. They give you kind of tone, preset tones and boosts and things, which I won't actually demonstrate here. I'll just demonstrate the guitar as such. So also on the tone control, it's got a notch at the end which bypasses the tone control. So with that notched full up like that, the tone's going straight out of the guitar to the amp with no tone control on it. So I'll leave the tone control in. Here it is, pretty much wide open. That's a really nice, gutsy, I suppose, a Clapton-y type, bluesbreaker-y, creamy era tone. Like the Junior, you knock it back, fattens up a lot. That's a lovely sound. Very vocal. And if you... I'm not using a pick, I'm just using my fingers. You can really milk the sound of that. And you might not be inclined to do that on a two or three pickup guitar because you've got all the switches, you've got all the preset tones you can mess about with. But I love that. Pick lightly, pick hard, use a pick, use your fingers. Interact with the guitar a bit more than you might on, say, a Strat or a multi-pickup guitar. But this is a really, really nice guitar. I love its lightweight. I love the fact that it's, without those switches, it's very simple. A lot of people will like those switches because they do give nice, gutsier sounds. They're not for me, though, but it's a great little guitar, really great guitar.
So this is the Gordon Smith GS1, obviously handmade in the UK, and with prices starting around £450, you can't really argue with that. There's not a lot of other companies out there that can offer that kind of service. And while it's obviously based on a Junior-style template, there's a couple of different things going on here, because we've got solid cedar neck and body and a charred ash fingerboard, which is obviously different to vintage 1950s Gibson spec. It's a very lightweight guitar. It feels almost flyaway in a way, but it's nice and resonant, and it's got some great sounds too. So we'll just have a little look at that. Mm-hmm. obviously a nice big strident bridge humbucker sound, aided and abetted by the lightweight body. It's a big brash sound, and it's great for rock and roll. And you know, much like the Gibson Junior, if you sort of go over to the fingers and just play really lightly and mess around with the right hand position a little bit, you can get some nice soft textures out of it too. That's before you even touch the controls. So like Nev, I probably wouldn't go for the additional switching myself, because I think for me, a big part of the appeal of a single pickup guitar is the simplicity and the direct nature of it. You know, but it's there if you want it as a custom option. And we, you know, we'd applaud Gordon Smith for offering that sort of thing again at such a competitive price point. The only thing I would say is that for somebody who's 6 foot two like me, a guitar as compact as this does feel a little bit like strapping on a lollipop or a banjo or something. But having said that, due to the construction, you can't argue with the upper fret access. It's absolutely fantastic. And it's no wonder that people have used Gordon Smith guitars for slide over the years, because for that sort of playing style, it does give you absolute access to everything that you're going to need up at the dusty end as well.
This is Dave Bucket Colwell's signature Fret King. It's an Eclat. It's actually, they've always made good sounding guitars. We've never really found a Fret King that we didn't like the sound of. As usual, Trev Wilkinson's tweaked it around a bit. You can see where this comes from, because there's one not a million miles from it that we played earlier on. But he's tweaked around. He's put an armrest in there that he wants. It's, you know, that might be a bit more comfortable. He's sharpened up the horn there. He's nicked a bit out of that. The P90 is in a very similar place to the Junior, so it's quite far forward, which will give the guitar an inherent fatness that the humbucking guitars, where the pickups nearer the bridge, don't quite have. Again, it's a very recognisable kind of sound. Knock back the tone. If you knock the volume right back again. That's quite a nice, it's quite a nice jangle to that sound. It's a nice guitar. It's quite heavy. I think it's heavier than the Les Paul Junior. But that will give it, that'll give it a bit of added guts. This, in a way, this sounds to me like you expect a P90 guitar to sound. It's got that slightly nasal quality to it. It kind of does what it says on the tin, really, this one, I think. But it does sound good. You'd have a great time with this. No add-ons. There's none of Trev's varicoil stuff going on here. It's a simple tone control. So you know what you get with this guitar. And it works really well.
So over to the Fret King then. And obviously we're in very much Les Paul Junior derived territory here, albeit with a few bites taken out of the original body shape. And you've got the forearm chamfer, which we're not really too sure what to think of it aesthetically, but it certainly does make for a comfortable feel with the arm travelling over the top there. And round at the end of the neck, you've definitely got improved access thanks to this slightly different cutaway shape here and this bite here, which almost makes it a double cut guitar, but not quite, sort of a single cut and a half, if you like. And tonally, we're in similar territory to the Junior. I think it's slightly more nasal quality to it, as Nev mentioned. You haven't quite got that kind of raucous, balls-to-the-wall sort of rock and roll vibe that you get out of the Junior, and maybe some of that's due to the poly finish kind of inhibiting some of the natural resonance in a way that the nitro on the Les Paul Junior, the aged wood, obviously that's a very different animal. But you can get some really good sounds out of this. So sort of full throttle, you've got this. You know, and if you're doing sort of any kind of rootsy, raw rock and roll music, there's not a lot wrong with that at all. And again, you know, without even touching any of the controls, if you just back off a little bit with the right hand and use fingers, you can get, you know, really nice velvety sort of lead textures as well.
guitars don't really get much cooler looking than this. This is the Eastwood Airline 59, and it's a lovely single coil guitar. It looks brilliant. It's got a chambered mahogany body. Obviously, the original ones would have been a kind of plastic fiberglassy type thing. But that's a really, really cool looking guitar. It's actually, although it's a humbucker housing, there's a single coil inside there. So it just has a single volume control, no tone. But I think it was Eddie Van Halen that said, your volume control is your tone control. And he's right, because you watch this. That's flat out. As soon as I knock that back, note how the treble vanishes. That's a lovely sound there. That's a really nice sound in that position. Again, it cleans up really nicely when you turn it down. Slightly weird positioning of the control here. I wouldn't get along with that very well. But with a guitar like this, it's all about the looks, and you get round those obstacles, as certain people we know well have done. It's a great guitar, actually, and it does sound nice.
So as Nev suggested, this is a different kettle of fish altogether from the previous guitars. You've got no tone control. You've just got the volume control for tonal variance. And, you know, there's obviously a big Jack White thing going on here because of his use of vintage airlines for quite a number of years in the White Stripes. And certainly for that sort of bold, big rock and roll sound, then it's a great platform for that. So let's hear some of that. Or maybe, you know, for a little bit of the sort of garage blues thing as well. Kind of the scruffier the better. I reached down then to go for the volume control, expecting it to be that by there, as it, you know, usually would be on almost any other guitar, but of course it's all the way back there, which is a little bit fiddly. But as ever with these kind of pawn shop sort of guitars, that kind of aesthetic, you do have to compromise a little bit, you know, and there's a little bit of style over substance here. But having said that, it does sound absolutely great for that sort of thing. And the single coil sheep in wolf's clothing, single coil in a humbucker housing, does give you that extra top and that extra bite, which you maybe wouldn't get out of a full-size humbucker with this kind of scale length.
Here we have a classic series Esquire from Fender. This is the other famous single pickup guitar, and it's kind of the opposite to the Les Paul Junior. The Les Paul Junior clearly is the big, fat, raunchy guitar. This is the twangsome beast. So it's essentially a Telecaster without the neck pickup. But Fender have done some clever things with the switching so that it actually gives you more than you might think. So with the selector in the middle position, it's classic Tele style bridge pickup. So the volume control works. And the tone control works. If you put it in that position, that defeats the tone control, so it's a very sharp, bright sound. Can't do anything with it. That's what you get. You can tweak the volume, so it does change things quite a lot. I think that's what people think a Tele bridge pickup or Esquire bridge pickup sounds like. In this position, it's a pseudo neck pickup tone, really. They've stuck a couple of capacitors and a resistor in there. It's quite a usable sound, actually. Possibly more than you might think. So it's quite a sweet sound. Quite chunky old thing. It's got quite a big neck on it. But let's use it as the kind of Tele bridge pickup here. So it's not as much power in this pickup as the other guitars that we've got, because they're naturally more beefy kind of affair. But it's really nice. The great thing about the Esquire also is that you can do things that you can. It works great with pedals, so you can fatten that up with pedals and give it more guts with pedals. And of course, you know, it's cheaper to change one pickup than it is to change three. So if that's another option, but it's a great guitar. And again, just like the other ones, if you learn to use this guitar as it's meant to, you milk the tones, you use different picking ideas, and you learn where different things on the tone control and volume control react with a guitar, you can get a whole load of stuff out of the guitar like this.
So over to the Esquire then, and much like Nev, I'm in very, very familiar territory here. I've gigged an Esquire, you know, I'm a Telecaster fan, so everything about this guitar is immediately very, very appealing. And the aesthetic, which of course dates back to 1950, I still think these are, you know, some of the coolest, most beautiful electric guitars ever made. So despite the visual simplicity, it's something of a Trojan horse because of the tricky stuff that's going on with the wiring. And the great thing is you can set it up for a nice rhythm sound, with plenty of bite, sat in the middle there, roll the tone back a touch maybe, and then it gives you an easy way to bypass that tone control, flick that switch. And that's a really good way to get a little bit of extra top end and bite again then for the lead sound. So you might do something like this.
Clearly, if the option were to take away the Les Paul Junior, I would have that. But sadly, I can't because my mate Dave Burlock owns it and he wouldn't let me near it. Well, he has let me near it, but he wouldn't let me have it. So of the remaining guitars, I would take the Esquire. Because I love Tellies, I love the Telly, whole Telly ethic, I love the single pickup ethic. If it were mine, I'd probably beef the pickup up with something else, and I'd probably put brass saddles on it. But this would be a great working guitar. It's one of those guitars that you can pimp a bit if you want to, because it's basically asking for it. I quite fancy having a go on an Esquire again for a while, so I might have a chat with Fender about this.
Okay, so while every single day of the week my heart would say that I would take the Les Paul Junior, unfortunately my wallet says no. So realistically, it's got to be a toss-up between these two guitars. Now, the Airline is just a fantastic brash platform for garage rock and all sorts of other kind of indie and grunge styles and things like that. I would possibly worry that people thought I was a little bit of a Jack White wannabe. I don't think you can really take that artist association away from this. And, you know, while I'm a big fan, I probably wouldn't want to sort of paint myself into a corner too much stylistically. So I think all things considered, I probably would go for the Esquire. I'm a big Telecaster fan. I've gigged Esquires in the past and had a really good time with them. And I think this guitar would be a really good platform for modding as well, because like Nev, I'd probably replace that bridge pickup with something with a bit more of a broadcaster spec just to give it more punch. And although Fender did use steel saddles on Tellies in the mid-50s from 1954, I probably prefer the sound of the early 50s brass saddles. And I think that would help give it a little bit more sort of a little bit more bite, a little bit more girth as well in all the right places. So it's a difficult choice because all of these guitars are really, really good and they have a lot to offer. But if I was going to spend cash on a new guitar, I'd probably go for the Esquire purely because it's so familiar. It's such a good platform for modifications and I know that I'd have a really good time with it.
Hi there, this is Max Hellier and I play in a band called You, Me at Six, and I'm going to show you one of the guitars I'm in love with at the moment. It's actually a Chris Cornell 335 Gibson. It's a signature model. The reason why it kind of caught my eye was the satin finish. I hadn't seen a 335 in a satin finish at all, so it kind of just jumped out at me. I actually looked at the one with the Bigsby on beforehand, and I picked up in a tri-plane the one with the Bigsby, and I didn't feel like it had enough resonance when I was playing the guitar, so I asked to try this one out, and yeah, literally, it was the minute I played it, I think I fell in love with it almost instantly, and I went back the next day and bought it, and I got it from a place called Sam Ash in LA in California. It's on Sunset Boulevard, and one of the cool things about it is it's numbered number 5 out of 250 at the back, so I got the fifth one, which is a pretty cool feeling to have, you know. And one of the special features about this guitar is the Lola pickups in the 335. It's got so much more bite to it compared to a normal 335 humbucker pickup that it to me just spoke volume straight away when I put it through an amp. It was like, it was almost like what I was looking for out of a 335. And I used it for pretty much a lot of the new album we've used on Cavalier Youth. I used it quite a bit and became one of my favorite guitars. And also with the Saturn finish as well, over time, it starts to wear down and it starts to show the gloss. As you can see on the back, it's, I'd move it a little bit and it's kind of got that reflecting wear down look. And I think it's just going to be a guitar that I'm going to constantly love and play throughout the rest of my life, you know. And it's just, if you're a 335 player, definitely look into the Chris Cornell models. They're unbelievable, probably one of my favourite signature models from the 335 ranges.
I'm afraid that's all we've got time for this month, but come back next time for more from the Gear Show from the makers of Guitarist, Total Guitar, Guitar Techniques Magazine and MusicRadar.com.